College is supposed to be a time of growth, expanding your education, and experiencing newfound freedom. But what happens when all of that is disrupted by a culture of alcohol-fueled adults, peer pressure, and sexual assault? Let's talk about that. That everyone thinks of when it comes to college is frat parties, hanging out with friends, and countless hours in the library studying. I know the last one doesn't sound quite as appealing, so it's not going to be included in today's conversation. But the experiences that people don't like to talk about when it comes to college is the countless instances of sexual assault and rape. It is said that 1 in 6 women have been victims of completed or attempted rape. 1 in 4 women will experience sexual assault in their lifetime. Now, those seem like pretty high percentages, and they are, especially due to the fact that almost half of the US population is female. Now, the most shocking statistic is next. Only about 55% of sexual assaults are reported, less are looked into, and even less are prosecuted by law. We all know that sexual assault and rape are bad, so why are so few reported and prosecuted? This is where we get into today's video topic, rape culture. Now, rape culture is something we've probably all heard of, but no one has really delved into what it actually means and what it has to do with our society today. According to Marshall University, rape culture is an environment where rape is prevalent and sexual violence against women is normalized and excused by the media and popular culture. The phrase emerged in the 1970s and was used publicly about colleges in a study from 1987. Nobody hears that definition on a daily basis. We all know myths and sayings that contribute to rape culture. Phrases such as boys will be boys, or locker room talk, victim blaming, alcohol blaming, and normalizing sexual violence all contribute to rape culture. We hear it in everyday life, and some people still think nothing of it. However, in college, it has become a big problem. For colleges, rape culture focuses around Greek life and alcohol. According to Joskowski and Wiersma Mosley, most college sexual assault instances and rape happen either during or after a party ran by a fraternity. As other articles also point to, it has to do with the heavy alcohol use and groupthink when it comes to rape myths. Now, I'm not saying that alcohol is the reason for sexual assault or is an excuse for it. It's just several statistics that show there's a correlation between sexual assault and alcohol in college. With fraternities, there comes this phenomenon called groupthink. Groupthink is where the desire to fit in and not cause controversy causes an individual to conform to the group's ideas and behaviors despite how destructive or how much they may disagree with them. Fraternities are tied to adherence to rape myths, and this comes with groupthink and stronger beliefs of male dominance. In the article by Joskowski and Wiersma Mosley, they identify a study that looked at sexual assault habits and percentages between boys who entered and who did not enter fraternity in the first academic year of college. Alcohol is a pretty prevalent substance in the life of college students and surrounds the majority of college sexual assault cases. Still focusing on Greek life, alcohol is a major factor at fraternity parties. Some require to bring your own alcohol, where others provide it for you. You just have to pay an entrance fee. This is talked about in an article by Emily Hopkins. From research done in her own college and several others in her area, she discusses how this creates gendered spaces. This is due to the fact that parties that require you to pay at the fraternity houses, women do not have to pay. However, because of this, the boys at the party believe that the females owe them something, primarily sex, due to the fact that they did not have to pay to attend the party or drink the alcohol provided. This is a myth that fuels rape culture, that somebody owes another individual something for either buying them dinner, buying them a drink, or just being nice to them in general. When the female refuses, this can escalate to sexual assault. The use of alcohol, there's also a doubled standard. When the rapist is drunk, the brain is fogged and they can't make proper decisions. However, if the victim is drunk, they were responsible for what happened and were asking for it. Now, some of you may be thinking that this isn't as big as a deal as I'm making it seem. However, rape culture and rape on college campuses have made national news in the recent years. The biggest one comes from 2016 and just resurfaced recently. Brock Turner was a Stanford swimmer that, after a party, raped a female student who was passed out behind a dumpster. He was stopped by 2 other male students who had attended the party. Now, you think with 2 witnesses, the victim being unconscious, therefore no consent, and testifying herself, he would get a pretty hefty sentence. This was not the case. The trial caused uproar across the nation for several reasons, and they all focused around rape culture. Turner was sentenced to only 6 months in jail, and he only served 3 due to good behavior. During his trial, his achievements and status as a swimmer going to Stanford on a swimming scholarship were used as a defense as why he shouldn't go to jail and why the victim should not be believed. His father was also quoted saying, His son's life should not be ruined for 20 minutes of action. Alcohol was also blamed, but mainly towards the victim. All of these adhere to rape myths that contribute to keeping rape culture alive. The victim was blamed for drinking, therefore the double standard. Perpetrator's achievements were used as a defense, and his light sentence contributes to the normalization of sexual assault. Another case that contributes to rape culture and affects me and several other University of Florida students surrounds Ian Malasky. Ian Malasky was a senior here at UF and was a head RA. After a lot of drinking, he called a friend to help him back to his dorm. The friend, female, helped him back to his dorm, and there he held her down on the bed and tried to sexually assault her. She fought, got away, and had another friend of hers help her back to her dorm and stay with her for the night. A few hours later, Malasky gets into her dorm and tries to lay with her. He was arrested, bail was set, but was released without paying for many reasons. One was due to his status as a high-achieving student. He was an economics major and a head RA. Once again, status being used as a defense to his crimes. His attorney also called the situation a misunderstanding between platonic friends fueled by alcohol. Instead of calling it what it is or holding his client accountable, alcohol was blamed and the situation was labeled a misunderstanding. In this episode, we discuss the definition and origins of rape culture, its surveillance on college campuses, myths and factors, including two cases that contribute to keeping rape culture alive. Thank you for watching this, and I'll see you in the next video.